And welcome to the committee's 26th meeting in 2020. Can I ask everyone please to make sure their mobile phones are on silent? And I'm always nervous to make sure that mine is, having been caught out before. Now, the meeting will be conducted in hybrid format with some of our members and all of our witnesses participating remotely. I've received no apologies from the committee members, although Angus MacDonald will not be joining us until slightly later due to other parliamentary business. Can I remind remote members that they will need to put an R in the BlueJeans chat box to request to speak. So the first item on the agenda is subordinate legislation, and this is to consider two affirmative instruments and one notice laid under the affirmative procedure as detailed on our agenda. Now, the committee will take evidence from the Minister for Rural Affairs and Natural Environment and her officials who are participating remotely. Before we go any further, I do think it's important, though, that members declare any interest they have in relation to farming items. So I am going to go first to Peter Chapman and then to Stuart Stevenson. Peter.
Thank you, convener. I need to declare an interest in a farming partnership that I am involved with.
OK, and Stuart Stevenson, I think you would like to make a declaration.
Thank you very much, convener. I am part owner of a very small registered agricultural holding upon which sheep regularly graze. I take no income from it. Thank you.
Thank you, Stuart. And I too would like to make a declaration that I have an interest in a family partnership, a farming partnership in Murray. Now, those declarations of interest will remain intact for the whole of the session, because this deals with other agriculture ministers as well. So the motion seeking the approval for the affirmative instruments and notices will be considered at items 2 to 4. And members should note that there have been no representations to the committee on these. First of all, I'd like to welcome from the Scottish Government Mary Goujon, the Minister for Rural Affairs and the Natural Environment, Andrew Vose, the Veterinary Head of Animal Welfare, and Grant McClarty, who is a solicitor. Now, Minister, I wonder if you'd like to make a brief opening statement on the two SIs and the notices. Minister. You're still muted. Minister, could I ask you to start again, because you were muted. So if you could start that again, please.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. Sorry. I hope you can hear me now. But it's just to say, if you want me to talk about both SSIs back to back, I'd be happy to do that. And I'll start with the mandatory use of closed circuit television in slaughterhouses. Now, CCTV offers benefits in increasing public trust and processes that processes are carried out properly and in accordance with legal requirements as a means of identifying animal welfare issues or incidents that might be missed by physical observation, as a source of evidence in cases of reported wrongdoing, as a management tool to assess and evaluate slaughterhouse operations, and as a valuable tool in staff training in the handling and welfare of animals. And the instrument will ensure full coverage of all slaughtering operations in areas in which live animals are present in Scottish slaughterhouses in order to fully achieve the welfare benefits that are associated with CCTV monitoring. Now, the desired full coverage will be ensured by the requirement on food business operators to install and maintain CCTV equipment that complies with the regulations. And food businesses will also be required to arrange for the retention and storage of images and information captured by the compliant CCTV equipment for a period of 90 days. That time period is considered to be proportionate in that it will allow sufficient time for footage to be reviewed and for unreported events to come to light and not be destroyed before potential use as evidence for court and non-court proceedings and for staff training purposes. And the CCTV footage will also enable official veterinarians to observe animals in high welfare risk areas, as well as those that are dangerous or inaccessible to people, and identify animal behaviours that might be hidden from human observers. The regulations will provide Food Standards Scotland with powers of unrestricted access to CCTV output for the purpose of monitoring and verifying animal welfare standards in approved slaughterhouses. And that will be similar to current provisions in the Welfare of Animals at Time of Killing Scotland Regulations 2012, whereby FSS can request any footage currently covering parts of a slaughterhouse. The welfare of animals will be improved by the power to immediately act data rather than waiting for a request to be fulfilled. Now, the regulations also give Food Standards Scotland enforcement powers in order to check compliance with CCTV requirements, and that include powers of inspection and powers to seize CCTV equipment, and if necessary, seized equipment can potentially be used as evidence of non-compliance. However, the regulations require Food Standards Scotland to return any seized equipment, images and data to the food business operator if they're not required in court proceedings, as soon as that's reasonably practicable. And that requirement should ensure the smooth operation for the industry. The Enforcement Authority is also given the power, again, similar to the currently in operation under the Welfare of Animals at the time of Killing Regulations 2012, to issue enforcement notices to remedy any contravention of the regulations. The food business operators are also provided with an appeals mechanism for any enforcement notices served. And in relation to such appeals, a sheriff may uphold or deny the appeal and change the enforcement notice. And on the basis of that, I don't know whether you want me to move directly on to make comments about the next SSI, or I'd be happy to take questions on this one at this point.
I think we'll see if there's any questions at this stage, Minister, if that's all right. So, Peter, you've got a question.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I noticed from the report there are 30 slaughterhouses in Scotland, 24 in the mainland, which have already got at least some CCTV in place, and six on islands where none of them have any CCTV. Now, I'm sure the island slaughterhouses are quite small, and the funding, I'm sure they would all say that they're not making large profits. So is funding an issue with the six island slaughterhouses? My question is really, are they content and willing and happy to go ahead with this? And is there a funding issue for them to find the necessary cash to go forward?
That is an issue that's been raised by some of the smaller island slaughterhouses, but that's why I wrote to the six island slaughterhouses last week to say that we are looking to provide financial assistance to them to help with the installation of CCTV equipment, because they don't have that at the moment, and we've offered that up to £5,000. So we are willing to help and try and provide that assistance for island slaughterhouses, because we do recognise the circumstances that they're in, and it may be more difficult for them to install this equipment.
Thank you, Minister. Maureen, did you have a question? The Deputy Convener, Maureen Watt.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Currently, we don't have any mobile slaughterhouses, but in the event that we might have, are they covered by this legislation? Or would they be? In other words, would they have to have CCTV on a mobile slaughterhouse?
Minister.
That is something that we would have to look at. I mean, as you've rightly said, we don't have mobile abattoirs in place at the moment. We did have a study which looked at that to see if that would be an option or something that we should investigate further. So it is something that we are actively considering. And of course, this would factor into any future decisions that we take on those, if that's something that we decided to pursue.
You're happy with that? I think John Finney would like to come in on this. John.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I would like to follow up on my colleague Peter Chapman's question there, particularly with regard to the island slaughterhouses. This is a very important animal welfare provision that you're bringing forward, and I warmly welcome it and will support it. I also welcome that the government are looking at the issue of providing some support. I just wonder, could you keep the committee advised of that, please? Because this is an issue that does cause concern, that given it's an animal welfare provision, we most certainly want to retain the island slaughterhouses rather than perhaps have beasts moved off the islands for slaughter. So could you keep the committee appraised of how that's going, please?
Minister.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, I'd be happy to keep the committee informed of that, because I absolutely recognise the importance of these facilities on the islands. And again, that's why we want to offer the financial help to enable them to comply with the regulations as well. So when it's come to any issues that have been raised with the regulations, and when we had the initial consultation, we've really worked to take all those issues on board and work with them as much as possible to ensure that they're able to comply with these regulations. But I'm more than happy to keep the committee appraised of these discussions as we move forward and as we look to implement the regulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Now, Christine Graham, who's attending the committee as a member of the Parliament, would like to ask questions. So, Christine Graham.
Is it come on? Yeah, just a quick one. I campaigned on this for years, but I want to ask, what's the timescale for making sure that the CCTV is in all areas, including layerage and so on, in the slaughterhouses? What does the Minister think the timescale is for this to be implemented?
Minister.
Well, the regulations come into force on the 1st of July next year. So that's when we'll be looking to have these fully in force and have all slaughterhouses compliant.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Minister, I just have a question as well, if I may. The storage of the films for 90 days, how did you settle on 90 days as being the right period of time? Because sometimes, as you know, incidents come to light after that. Minister.
I believe it was felt that 90 days, as I said in my opening statement, was adequate enough time for that to be stored and for that would potentially allow enough time for if any incidents came to light and CCTV footage was needed. It's felt that that's been an adequate amount of time for that. I don't know if officials have anything further to add to that, but I believe that may be the length of time that's in operation elsewhere.
Okay.
And as far as I'm aware, there haven't been any further issues in relation to the 90-day timeframe.
Thank you, Minister. One other question, if I may, and having come from a farming background, I know how important farmers feel that livestock are treated properly when they go to slaughterhouses. What opportunities are there for farmers to be able to check footage to make sure that their animals have gone through the process correctly? Because it is, I would think, very important to the majority of farmers in Scotland that this process is done as humanely as possible.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, but I think we also have to be careful about the data elements of this and who has access to that information. So within the regulations, it would be Food Standards Scotland who would have access to the footage, which I think is the most appropriate for what we're looking at here. So when it comes to CCTV and who would be viewing that, that would be up to Food Standards Scotland.
So farmers could go to them if they felt there was an issue? Minister.
I would have to ask officials about that particular instance or how that would work. And if they believed there was an issue and they reported that to Food Standards Scotland and Food Standards Scotland were then to investigate it, they would be the ones that would be looking at the CCTV footage themselves. Okay. And they would be obliged to investigate that. But again, if officials have any further information, I don't know if Andrea has anything further there.
Andrew, I don't know if you do have anything to add there. Sorry, Andrew, do you want to come in?
I would have to ask officials about that particular instance.
Yes, sorry, I've been having connection problems, so I didn't catch the last couple of minutes of that conversation, so sorry, I didn't catch the question.
I think there is some issue with connection, Andrew. I think I'm satisfied personally with the answer that the Minister has given me, but I wanted to give you the opportunity to come in if need be. But I am satisfied with the answer, so I'm not going to rehearse the arguments again, if I'm... And I'd like to now move on, thank you, Andrew, to the Minister again to speak to the other part of the notice. Minister.
In relation to the laying hens guidance?
The other SI in relation to the to this. Thank you. Welfare of Animals, Minister. That
okay.
SI. Thank you. Sorry, this is confusing.
Okay, thank you.
Off you go.
No problem. I'll make my comments in regards to that now. So the purpose of the draft regulations is to amend the Welfare of Farmed Animals Scotland Regulations 2010 to put a statutory duty on those responsible for looking after laying hens to be acquainted with our new laying hens guidance. And the committee will remember that these regulations were amended last year following the publication of our guidance for the welfare of meat chickens. So, amongst other things, the 2010 regulations require that those responsible for farmed animals are acquainted with any relevant animal welfare code and have access to that code while attending to the animal. They also require that anyone employed or engaged by the person responsible for the animal is acquainted with, has access to, and has received instruction and guidance on the code. The regulations make non-compliance with those requirements an offence. So, following publication of the guidance for the welfare of meat chickens last year, we amended the 2010 regulations so that these requirements in relation to codes of practice would also apply in relation to animal welfare guidance documents. So, anyone responsible for a farmed animal must also be acquainted with any relevant animal welfare guidance. The advantage of guidance documents is that they can be revised and updated quickly and so can be more easily kept in line with new thinking on good practice. However, the fact that they can be revised and updated at any times means that it's necessary to define in the regulations exactly which guidance documents those responsible for farmed animals should be acquainted with. And that's why when we amended the regulations last year, we defined animal welfare guidance as the new guidance for the welfare of meat chickens, which we had just published. So, as the committee will be aware, we published new guidance for the welfare of laying hens and pullets on the 21st of August this year. So we now need to widen the definition of animal welfare guidance in the 2010 regulations to include this guidance too. So the effect will be that anyone responsible for looking after laying hens and anyone they employ to look after their hens will be required by law to be acquainted with the new laying hens guidance and to have access to it when they're attending to those hens. The revocation notice we're also looking at today is to revoke the existing code of practice on laying hens. And that will avoid there being any confusion as to which guidelines should be followed by stockkeepers and what they have a statutory duty to be acquainted with. The combined effect of the documents we're looking at today then will be that the old code of practice on laying hens will no longer be in force, and the requirements which had been in force in relation to this code will now apply in relation to the new laying hens guidance. And again, I'd be happy to take any questions from the committee on this.
Thank you, Minister. I'm looking around the room. There's one question from Peter Chapman. Peter.
Thanks, Convener. I just wonder, Minister, how are you going to get the message out to the industry that there has been a change to the regulations? I mean, is there any budget or any way that this is going to be relayed to the industry? I mean, it's important that folk know what the changes are.
Minister.
Yeah. Peter Chapman is absolutely right. It's vital that industry are aware, but I would say that we work very closely with industry when we're developing the guidance anyway, and a lot of them are working to the standards that we've put forward in the guidance. So, but I mean, because the guidance does cover commercial producers, it covers smallholders or hobby farmers as well, that it does cover a wide range. So that's why we are setting out to really make direct communication with as many people as possible to make them aware of the new guidance and the fact that will be enforced if it's agreed. And it's already been published, so to make them aware of that. But again, we do work very closely with industry on this, so I think that the guidance is there and be working to that. But again, we will be doing what we can to make sure that we engage with as many people as possible and ensure that they are aware, and using all our various media channels and social media channels to get that message out.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Minister. There doesn't appear to be any other questions. So we're going to move on to agenda item 2. And this is the formal consideration of motion S5M 22891 that the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee recommends that the mandatory use of closed circuit television in slaughterhouses, Scotland, regulations 2020 draft be approved. I'm going to ask you, Minister, to formally move the motion, please.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? The question, therefore, is that motion S5M 22891 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Agreed. We are agreed. So we now move on to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of motion S5M 22766, that the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee recommends that the Welfare of Farmed Animals Scotland Amendment Regulations 2020 be approved. Minister, I'd ask you to move the motion formally, please.
Formally moved.
Are there any comments that you'd like, further comments you'd like to make on this, Minister?
No further comments from me,
okay.
Convener.
Are there any comments that members want to make? There doesn't appear to be. So the question is that motion S5M22766 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Therefore, we'll move on to agenda item 4. This is the formal consideration of motion S5M22820 that the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee recommends that the Code of Practice for the Welfare of Laying Hens Revocation Scotland Notice 2020 be approved. Minister, can I ask you to move the motion and make any further comments you wish to make?
Any further convener, and I would formally move.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? No. So the question is that motion S5M22820 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Now I'm going to suspend the meeting briefly to allow the changeover of the remote witnesses. Minister, thank you, and for you and to your officials for attending the meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting. And welcome back to this meeting of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. And we are going to move on to agenda item 5, which is the Dogs Protection of Livestock Amendment Scotland Bill. Today we're going to take evidence on the Dogs Protection of Livestock Amendment Bill. And I'd like to welcome Christine Graham, who's joining the committee for this item as Emma Harper's substitute. Emma is participating in this item as a member in charge of the bill and not as a committee member. Members have already made a declaration of interest in relation to farming, and those remain extant. I would like to welcome the panel. First of all, I'd like to welcome Emma Harper, who is the member in charge of this bill, Nick Hawthorne, who's the Senior Assistant Clerk, Non-Government Bills Unit, Kenny Hetkin, the Solicitor of the Scottish Parliament, and Charles Livingston, partner of Brodie's solicitors. Emma, would you like to give a 3-minute opening statement? And as a member of the committee, you will know how strict I am on my timings. So, Emma, good morning, welcome, and the floor is yours, as it were.
Good morning, convener, and good morning to everybody. I welcome the opportunity to attend the committee this morning to discuss the Protection of Livestock Amendment Scotland Bill. As members know, I am currently taking this bill through the legislative process to improve, strengthen and allow for better protection against the understanding of the issue of livestock worrying in Scotland. I've been working on this bill since early 2018 when I announced my intention to bring it forward. And since then, I've carried out both formal consultation through the consultation for the bill, which received over 600 full responses, and informal consultation through stakeholder engagement, roundtable meetings in Parliament, a meeting with people from all sides of the issue, and meeting with constituent farmers and stakeholder organisations. Many of the organisations include the NFUS, the NSA, Scottish SPCA, Police Scotland Dogs Trust, the Outdoor Access Forum and the BVA, to name a few. Throughout the process, I've tried to encompass all organisations, individuals and interested parties. The bill has a key policy objective, which is informed through both the formal and informal consultation, and the aim to improve the legislation around livestock worrying. If passed, the key changes of the bill will be implemented will be as follows. An increase in the maximum penalty for the offence of allowing out-of-control dogs to chase, attack and kill livestock to a fine of £5,000 or 6 months suspended sentence. It will also allow courts to ban a convicted person from owning a dog or from allowing their dog to go onto agricultural land. Indeed, it also provides the ability for courts to impose a ban on a convicted person's household from owning a dog. The bill will also give police greater powers to investigate and enforce the offence and provides greater clarity to Scotland's legal bodies, such as the Crown Office, Procurator, Fiscal Service, on how to deal with the offence. This is particularly important as during the consultation, this was identified as an issue with the current legislation. Additionally, the bill extends the definition of livestock in Scots law to include additional types of farm animals, such as camelids, i.e. llamas and alpacas. These changes in the bill will have been welcomed. They've been welcomed by Scotland's leading animal welfare and agricultural bodies, including the National Sheep Association and the National Farmers Union of Scotland. The bill generally provides clear protection to Scotland's hardworking farming community from loss and damage to their livestock, a crime which the consequences can be both financially but also emotionally devastating. Through the consultation, I also know that this is a crime for which the consequences are often limited and insufficient. So I welcome the opportunity to answer questions members have, and I look forward to working with members as we move forward. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Emma, and thank you for sticking to the time so assiduously. So the first question is going to be from the Deputy Convener, Maureen Watt. Maureen.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Emma and your associates. During your opening statement, you talked about the number of stakeholders and responses that you've had. It's obviously a very wide variety. But can you tell us whether during that consultation with all those various people and groups, whether, you know, what sort of changes you had to make in the way that you arrived at the appropriate legislative avenue to tackle this issue?
Emma.
Thank you, Deputy. We looked at various approaches when trying to gather all this different information, because one of the main things that people wanted was the ability to make the fines higher on the level 1 through 5 scale. So that was something that we looked at and included in the bill. Other issues that we looked at were education and addressing the issue of how would we put that or could we put that in the bill, other education opportunities are already being delivered, and we know that the Scottish Partnership Against Rural Crime are already engaging in work to tackle livestock worrying as part of their other rural crime issues. So we looked at lots of different ways of taking this forward, and ultimately the keep it simple approach was where we went forward, because the 1953 legislation is 67 years old, and we basically wanted to bring it up to date as simply as possible.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Maureen. We've got some further questions now from other members, so we'll move straight on to Colin Smith, who's got the next lot of questions. Colin.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Emma. Can I turn to the issue of current legislation, Emma, and how this ties in with what we already have on statutes? Work's obviously ongoing at present to review a number of areas of dog control legislation, and some of the stakeholders, you'll know from the evidence, have, although they're not opposing the principles of the bill, they did feel that a more coordinated approach to dog control legislation should be taken. So can you tell us why you chose to bring forward this particular legislation rather than wait for the results of ongoing reviews and try to incorporate some of that with what may be coming?
Emma.
Thank you, Colin, for that question. We did talk about like the bigger issue and lots of current work that's going on and the potential for consolidation legislation. My understanding is that consolidation legislation would take between 5 and 10 years. And the sense that I got from the chair of the National Sheep Association, as well as the National Farmers Union, many members that I spoke to over the last couple of years, I got a sense of urgency from them that they didn't want to wait another 5 to 10 years and have the number of incidences of livestock worrying continue. We've seen the number of incidences increase year on year for the last 10 years. And so the sense of urgency is what made me want to just focus on this piece of legislation, which ultimately can be used as preparatory work if further consolidation legislation is taken forward. But again, I wanted to basically do something now.
And just following up on that, Emma, one not as much solution, but probably complementary measure that's been proposed by some people is to align the bill with, if you like, the Control of Dogs Scotland Act 2010, and in particular, consider extending the use of dog control notices to police and potential inspecting bodies for use in the cases of livestock worrying. Do you have any particular views on that?
The dog control notices, which are part of the 2010 legislation, was something that we considered, but it's already available. And so dog control notices are part of the civil process in the 2010 legislation. But what we wanted to do was basically focusing on updating this old legislation. So it was something that we thought about, but my understanding is that it's already out there, and rather than muddy the waters, that legislation could still be used and is also used currently for livestock worrying offences.
Thank you, Colin. The next questions are going to come from John Finney. John, good morning.
Good morning, Convener. Good morning, Emma and panel. Emma, I'd like to, if I may, touch on the issue of penalties. And the majority of those who responded and stakeholders wanted a robust penalty regime. There was also concern that it would be proportionate. So can I ask what your rationale for the level of penalty outlined in the bill is, please?
Emma.
Thank you, John, for your question. The 1953 legislation has the highest penalty at a level one, which was £1,000. But in modern farming practices, we've seen that the cost or the money associated with various types of sheep in particular can be really, really quite high, up to, we've seen recently, some tups valued at 250,000 guineas. So as I looked at the old legislation comparing it with the new legislation, I wanted to just apportion a reasonable level one through five, so that the maximum penalty could be £5,000 or the minimum of a 200, I think it is, so that it would allow the prosecutors flexibility to assess cases based on individual incidents, and then they would apply what level of a fine would fit each individual incident of livestock attack.
John.
Okay. Thank you, Convener. Thanks for that, Emma. Another aspect, and we know from the Law Society, who have confirmed what indeed you've said previously in evidence, is that there already is a compensation regime in place in the Scottish justice system. But we also heard, and you touched on this yourself, the significant cost of some beasts, but also the relatively modest cost. To the figures from the Flynn, the SSPCA, £70, but also £30,000 for a particular pup. So compensation is clearly important, and that was highlighted by a number of the stakeholders. And it, as I say, it's a tool that's already available to the courts. Is this sufficient, or do you think that there needs to be, well, clearly perhaps you don't think there needs to be compensation provisions in the face of the bill? And if you do, do you have a view on how this could be determined and what could be done if a convicted person cannot pay? Because one of the other issues is on the question of insurance, is that uncertainty about what's being insured, whether it's £70 or the £30,000. Can you comment on that, please?
Emma, sorry.
Sorry, thanks, convener. I was waiting on your cue. So compensation orders do already exist, and we heard with the evidence that conducted by Flock Health that only 9% of farmers did claim compensation. And the Minister said when she provided evidence in her session that perhaps we maybe need to do more to raise awareness of the fact that compensation orders do already exist. I know that through discussions with the Non-Government Bills Unit that, you know, there is already this mechanism in place, and awareness raising might have to happen. And compensation orders, my understanding is that they would be, if part of, like, if somebody was required to pay the compensation and that was not affordable, that would be borne out of proceeds of crime, like financial availability. I mean, if I'm not being clear enough, it might be that Kenny is able to respond directly about how compensation orders are already work or already are in current legislation. And I chose not to put it in the bill because it's probably bigger than what a member's bill could actually be proposed and taken forward. I know that financial resolutions by the Parliament would then have to be processed if there was a wider financial issue associated.
Emma, I think...
John,
I think Nick Hawthorne wants to come in and add something to that. So if you wouldn't mind, John, I'd like to bring him in now and then I'll come back to you. Nick.
Thank you, convener. Yes, I just wanted to add something there to what Emma was outlining. And yes, it is the case, as Mr. Finney said, that compensation can happen at the moment, as the committee heard, through both a civil route and through other legislation. One thing the bill does do is improve that situation, because the bill increases the maximum penalty to include a six-month custodial sentence. That will allow the court to make, under a community payback order, to make a compensation requirement in lieu of the custodial sentence. But that cannot happen at the moment, That's linked to the Criminal Justice Licensing Act 2010. So by including that custodial sentence, it gives the courts an extra mechanism for requiring the compensation to be paid.
Nick, thanks very much. I'm going to come back to you, John, but I think Oliver and Rich Lahr might like supplementaries on this. So, John, you first. I'll come to you.
Thank you. Very briefly, because I appreciate colleagues have supplementaries. Emma, I wondered, had you had any engagement with the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service on this? Because you talk about awareness. It may be that that's something that the PF would need to make a request of the bench in an individual case. Is that something that's been discussed at all, please?
The Crown Office did respond to the initial consultation. And since then, I know that the Minister has met with them. So I'm waiting to hear from the Crown Office from an additional response ahead of this meeting, additional letter for me to, I guess, to seek an opportunity for them to respond on various issues that have been brought up. So I'm happy to pursue with them the response, and then I can feed that back to the committee as I hear.
Many thanks. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, John. Oliver, I think you might have a supplementary on this one, Oliver.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the member in charge for the helpful input already. I wondered, a few weeks ago, I asked some of the stakeholders about the possibility of introducing a sort of standard compensation scheme. It might not fix all the problems, but I wondered whether the member had heard that evidence and whether it's something she would support. I mean, I think the idea that we're going to find hundreds of thousands of pounds from some dog walkers to compensate landowners is probably unlikely, but I think it's an important gesture to make sure that at least some of the cost is recovered.
Emma.
Yep, thank you. Thanks, Oliver. I think the opportunity to compensate farmers is obviously really important for the farmers. It was one of the big issues that was raised by the NFUS, because of the amount of money that they have to input to pay for vets bills if there's sheep attacked or other issues that we've seen. So in the continued engagement with the minister, I think what I would need to do is go back to her to discuss it, because it would be up to the Scottish Government to bring forward a standard capped approach to compensation. I think it definitely is worth continuing to explore. I'd be happy to do that.
Oliver.
Just briefly, Convener, so I wondered whether Emma Harper would be happy for that, something like that, to be included on the face of the bill, and whether she'd be open to amendments later in the process.
Emma.
I'm not opposed to putting something on the face of the bill, but because compensation schemes already exist, I wanted to keep my bill as simple as possible as we move forward. And because there is other animal welfare legislation, and the working group that the Minister spoke about at her evidence session, I would prefer to look at compensation schemes or methods secondary to the primary bill, and look at maybe pursuing that in different ways in the future.
Okay, thank you, Emma. Richard Lyle's got some more questions on a slightly different subject. So, Richard, off you go with those. Richard.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Emma. Emma, many people are dog lovers and like owning a dog. In what case would you consider it to be appropriate for a person to be disqualified from owning a dog? Do you feel that this bill ensures that any such orders are proportionately applied? And to follow up what John Finney was asking you, have you spoken to the Procurator Fiscal, the Scottish Sentencing Council, on issuing sentencing guidance?
Emma.
The bill proposes flexibility in any approach. In the consultation process, we heard a wide range of examples of people thinking their dog was simply having a bit of fun and chasing sheep in a field, but these sheep happen to be pregnant at the time. And so then how do we know if that simple chase did result in pregnancies being aborted? We also heard other incidents of just blatant disregard, where one man said his Labrador attacked 5 sheep one day and 4 sheep the next day. And when he was approached about it, he said, so what? I'll just pay the fine. So we've had wide-ranging examples of livestock incidents. So I wanted to make sure there was flexibility in the bill so that the Crown Office or the prosecutors could use a case-by-case basis in order to decide how they wanted to take it forward. So a disqualification would be very, very rare. We have heard of repeat offences. There are very, very few individuals that would be disqualified, but we have heard some pretty harrowing stories where some people just shouldn't have a dog, and that would allow the Crown Office to basically disqualify that person.
Yes, as a former dog owner, I agree that anyone who owns a dog should be responsible and ensure that the dog doesn't do the things that you mentioned. So legal stakeholders have suggested that based on the provisions in the animal health and welfare legislation, it may be inappropriate to disqualify an owner from owning a dog where the welfare of the dog is otherwise well provided for. What are your thoughts in that case?
Emma.
I think the evidence that was presented by the Kennel Club talked about that, whereas the welfare of a dog is otherwise really, really, it's fine. And this particular incident might just be an incident. So again, it would be very, very rare that we would disqualify a person from having a dog. And that's why we built into the bill that the provision that we could ban somebody from having their dog on agricultural land. And that one example was a core path through a farm in Ayr, where this particular farmer was met with verbal abuse on multiple occasions. And so he would know this particular person. And if that offence could ban him from that particular land, that meant the farmer wouldn't have to face verbal abuse when he's out doing his work on the core path which goes through his land.
That's fine. Thank you, Gillian.
Thank you, Richard. The next question is from Angus MacDonald. Angus.
Okay, thanks, convener, and good morning to Emma. If I could stick with the issue of disqualification orders, can I ask you how you intend for disqualification orders aiming to prevent a person from bringing a dog onto agricultural land would work in practice? And did you have any particular circumstances in mind for such an order would be appropriate and practically feasible?
Emma.
It's something that in examples of looking at what incidences have happened up until now, that one particular example that I just talked about is something that the farmer would know this person coming onto the land, that he recognised the dog in the person, for instance, and so the disqualification would be on that piece of land in itself. It may be that we need to look at, further definition around that. Again, rather than go for a person and just disqualifying them, I wanted to have a bit of flexibility so that on individual incidents that have been reported, it would allow the police and the Crown Office to make an individual assessment and adjustment so that we could require somebody to not go to a particular place. Another issue might be somebody on holiday that had no idea that they were in a particular area that might be risky or livestock be on that land. And so that would then allow a process for a person to be made aware that a disqualifying from a particular place would be part of a requirement for them in the future.
Okay. Angus.
Thanks. That's fine, thank you.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Angus. The next questions then come from Peter Chapman. Peter.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Emma. I'm on enforcement of the bill, and I mean, you've suggested that you've proposed that additional inspecting bodies might be involved in enforcing the bill. And so can you outline your reasoning behind appointing additional inspecting bodies, and in what types of scenarios can you foresee this being of assistance? And who did you have in mind for the role of an additional inspecting body? And given that the local authorities and the SSPCA have both said that they're not keen to get involved in that, what would happen if a suitable or willing body could not be found?
Emma.
So in the whole process, when we started looking at how do we support the police in investigation of livestock worrying incidents, the dog control wardens and community safety teams and the SSPCA already support the police in investigation of incidents. One of the issues that came up was that the police don't have wands for microchip detection to hand. We know that for me locally, the police headquarters has a microchip wand, but all dog control wardens and community safety teams have the ability to identify a dog which has a microchip, and that would assist the police to track a dog who's running free without an owner anywhere near. We heard that during the evidence that 50% of incidents are latchkey dogs, or like dogs running free. And so once a dog is apprehended, we know that inspecting bodies or people who have got behavioural experience with dogs would be able to support the police and detain the dog. They've got the equipment, they've got the cages in the back of the car, they've got the wands for microchip detection, and they have the kit needed in order to seize or apprehend a dog. So that's where the thought of having additional support to help the police in their investigation. That's where that came from.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that, and I can understand the thinking behind it, but the problem I think you've got is that both local authorities and the SSPC have said to this committee that they don't particularly want this role. So how do you square that problem?
Well, it's in the bill, in the face of the bill, it doesn't say we're going to create inspecting bodies, but it does allow ministers to look at the opportunity of whether that would be necessary. So if when we engage in the process moving forward, because further conversation with the minister would need to take place to see if that was or not the propensity to do that. My understanding is that the SSPCA do already help, and if they're invited to support the police, they already do that. We know that dog wardens, one of the dog wardens in Argyll, is already well embedded with the support of the police in order to help look at incidents that happen. And so there are measures that are currently undertaken, but this again would allow ministers to appoint inspecting bodies if that was so determined as a need in the future.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I think you've made it quite clear, but I would like to just explore the relationship between Police Scotland and any inspecting body. Would the police be leading the investigation and the inspecting body assisting? And does this, if that is the case, and I think that's what you outlined there, so does this need to be clarified in the face of the bill, and specific guidance need to be developed around all this whole subject?
Emma.
So my goal would be that it would not need to be on the face of the bill, because we don't even know if the ministers would want to create inspecting bodies. My intention would be that the police would always be the lead in any investigation of any livestock worrying or any livestock attack incident, because the police are the experts in the process and the protocols. My goal would be that we would have guidance potentially created or standard operating procedures, so that if in the future ministers did decide to have inspecting bodies, that they would be subordinate and supportive to the police, and ultimately the police would be the lead and they would be in charge.
There's a supplementary here from Mike Rumbles. So I'm going to go to Mike Rumbles and then I'm going to go to the next question part of the sequence to John Finney. So, Mike Rumbles.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Emma. On the face of your bill, and I will just read it out, it says, the Scottish ministers may by regulations authorise one or more persons, organisations or bodies to appoint inspectors. And then an inspecting body may appoint an employee or somebody else. And before appointing a person, the organisation must consult with Scottish ministers. This is quite a departure from what we've done in the Parliament before and other legislation. Last year, I was a member of the committee looking at the UEFA European Championship Scotland Bill. And if I can read out from that, that we're talking about enforcement officers, which is the same situation here. And we were quite clear that enforcement officers, if they have powers similar to police officers, must be specified. It said, for instance, an enforcement officer is an individual designated by such by Glasgow City Council, and that person must be an inspector of weights and measures under the 1985 Act, is authorised by a local authority to enforce the provisions of the 94 Act, and employed by Glasgow City Council. In other words, we agreed that there should be an enforcement officer, or in your case, an inspecting officer, but that inspector should be specified on the face of the bill, because at the moment, the way the bill, you've written the bill, it gives tremendous opportunity for anybody effectively to be appointed, and there's no specific qualifications that those people have. So that's my concern, and I wondered if you could reflect on that.
Emma.
Okay, I take that concern quite seriously. I think that the purpose of the supporting inspecting bodies would be to offer assistance and guidance for the police. So inspecting bodies wouldn't be required to have the same judicial knowledge of the police inspecting inspectors or the police who investigate an incident. So again, it would be up to the ministers to appoint inspecting bodies, and through their own consultation and process, they would determine that a persons appointed then after that would have to have necessary qualifications or experience, and that would be up to the ministers to propose that should they decide to move that way in the future.
But my point is that this is our job as MSPs, as you quite understand, I'm sure, Emma, is to look at the proposed law as it is written. And what you have written gives a tremendous power to Scottish ministers to appoint anybody, basically, and they don't have to have qualifications. The reason I'm concerned about this is the other parts of your bill, and I'm going to go on to this in a moment, but I wanted just to refer to it. It's the power to authorise entry, search and seizure. And in section 4 of your bill, it gives a tremendous power to enter premises in some cases without a warrant. And so we've got to be really careful that Parliament scrutinises this. I'm fully supportive of the bill. I just want to make sure that we absolutely get it right. And I'm just concerned that we give too much power to an inspecting body and we can end up with real problems. And if you could look at the UEFA bill that we passed last year and have a look at that and see if that can be amended in similar terms.
Okay, now, Emma, just before you answer that question, if I may interrupt you, I think Nick Hawthorne would like to come in at some stage. I'm very happy to bring him in now if you're content to do that, or would you like to speak first?
I was actually going to say, Convener, that when the legislation was drafted, my understanding is that the drafter, Charles, looked at other legislation that was already out there, and perhaps Nick or Charles could explain in better legal terms, because I'm not a lawyer, how we came to the point where we are right now about inspecting bodies which haven't been assigned yet And if the ministers choose to do so, that would be proportionate in the way that that was developed. But I'm happy if Nick or Charles want to help support my ramblings.
Well, Charles has kept his head down, so we're going to go to Nick. So, Nick, you're up for this one.
Thank you, Convener. And just addressing some of the comments Mr. Rumble's made, and obviously it's for members to debate the policy aspects of this. I just thought it'd be helpful just to clarify in terms of the inspecting bodies. Yeah, this is a power that will be given to Scottish ministers. There is a requirement, so it's up to the ministers to decide whether to use the power at all. If they decide to do so, there's a requirement for them to consult the body that they've got in mind. So again, there's an opportunity there. If a body did not want to be appointed, then they could say that. One other thing I wanted to add was that in considering the delegated powers memorandum, the delegated powers committee wrote to Emma Harper to ask her to consider whether the affirmative procedure would be more appropriate. Currently in the bill, it suggested that the negative procedure is used for the regulations surrounding the appointment of inspecting bodies. And Emma Harper will be able to confirm this, but she replied to say that she would consider amending the bill to change that to affirmative procedure. So again, there will be an enhanced level of parliamentary scrutiny in terms of the appointment of any inspecting bodies.
Okay, I'm going to actually, before I come back to you, Emma, because I think that sort of clarified it quite a lot, I'd like to bring in Stuart Stevenson, and then I'll come back to you, Emma. Stuart. No, Stuart, you're muted. Just hold on a moment. No. What? Stuart, could you just start again? No, unfortunately, you're still muted. Okay, Stuart, just let... Stuart, hold on, don't touch anything. Just let broadcasting see if we could sort it out. If not, we'll come back to you later. No, I'm going to go back to Stuart. One more attempt to say something. Nope, we'll come back to you. Emma, can I come back to you if there's anything you want to add on that? If not, I'll go to John Finney. Emma?
I'm happy for you to move on. I'm keen to address any issues with the committee. And when we are looking at the process for affirmative instruments, I'm happy to engage and look at whatever we need to do in order to make this the best, strongest legislation going forward. Thanks.
Thanks, Emma. So, John Finney, you've got some questions here. So, over to you, John.
Thank you, Convener. Emma, as a follow-up, and I would very much align myself with the comments of my colleague Mike Rumbles there, I note that the bill would provide the Scottish Government the opportunity to appoint. But these are, again, significant police powers, and I think we need to be very cautious those charged with scrutinising legislation to understand that we should be very cautious on the issue of effectively police powers, which would be. Can I ask, as I did previously, have you consulted the police on the specific issues of the powers that would be granted and discussed the issue with the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service? And if you did, were any particular concerns expressed, please?
Emma.
Again, the Crown Office, I have written to them following evidence and I'm still waiting on a response. I do agree that when looking at how scrutiny by Parliament and then approval is extremely important, so I am happy to go back and look at that and respond again, because ultimately the goal is that we improve the legislation to have a flexible approach to dealing with this issue of livestock attacks.
John.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. Thanks for that. I'm sorry, I do need to press you on this. This is an important aspect of the bill, giving people the range of powers that is potentially suggested. So, has there been anything from either of these bodies thus far on that situation? That's either from the Crown or from the police.
And maybe just as a final thing, who would do the reporting to the Crown Office on any offences detected?
Emma.
My preference is that the police take the lead on this, and I do agree that it's really important that the police are in charge. Ultimately, if the ministers choose to move forward, whether they do a consultation process to have inspecting bodies, and then at what level do we want those inspecting bodies to be supportive in this, it would be up to the ministers and then through parliamentary scrutiny to agree or not with that process.
Can I bring in Charles Livingstone? Can I bring in Charles Livingstone at this stage? Because I think he's got something he'd like to add, and I'll come back to you, John, after that. Charles.
Thank you, Convener. I think I can hopefully just add a little bit. So to explain to the committee my roles as the drafter of the bill rather than anything to do with any of the policy. But in terms of the drafting and how it's all intended to fit together, I think it's worth noting that the appointment of the inspectors and the powers of the inspectors are broadly mirroring the terms of the Animal Health and Welfare Act 2006 and the position of inspectors under that regime. The difference in appointment is that under that regime, the Scottish Government can appoint inspectors directly, and that's a relatively unqualified power. The difference here is that inspecting bodies have an intermediary role. So it's in fact the inspecting body that is appointed, and they can then appoint inspectors. And it's a subtle distinction, but one of the reasons for that relates to the provisions in respect of who meets the costs and who can be reimbursed for the costs of any dog that is seized. So that's one of the reasons for having inspecting bodies rather than inspectors, so that the body can meet the costs and the individual inspectors don't find themselves having any liability there. Now, in terms of what inspectors can then do, I think it's been noted that it creates powers for inspectors, but it doesn't impose any duties on inspectors. So if a body is appointed for some reason without actually wanting to be, which seems unlikely, but if they were appointed against their wishes, there still would be no obligation on them to do anything in particular to use the powers. I think it's fair to say that the thinking is that a body such as the SSPCA or dog control officers in local authorities may well be the person on the scene in respect of a dog worrying offence, particularly if it's a stray dog. You might expect the SSPCA to be called out for that rather than necessarily the police being called out. So to a large extent, some of these powers would be about allowing them to react to a situation in which they might find themselves, rather than the SSPCA going out to investigate a criminal offence, which I'm sure they would not want to do. So I think it's important just to have that context and how that would fit together. And I think that we may come back to that in terms of the warrants, but the point that you're dealing with evidence that is both mobile and has a mind of its own in terms of the dog. So the person on the ground is possibly appropriate for them to have the same powers as police officers, even if they would not be investigating the criminal offence themselves.
John, back to you.
Well, I thank Mr. Livingstone for that was helpful. I'll perhaps leave it there at the moment. Thank you.
I think Stuart Stevenson wants to come in. Let's hope his microphone's fixed. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. The previous difficulty, there's actually a button on the cable, and my elbow had pressed it, switching the mic off. I just wanted to address the old chestnut about secondary legislation and ask the member to confirm that it is up to Parliament, whether it's negative or affirmative, the Parliament has the power to reject secondary legislation.
Emma, do you want to come back to that, or do you want to use the button?
uh, I always defer to Stuart Stevenson's superior knowledge to mine, and I agree that, you know, the whole scrutiny process and whatever we decide to adopt will be based on the agreement of committee and ultimately Parliament. So I'm happy to defer any expertise to others others than me.
Okay, thank you. Mike, do you have a further question on this?
Yes, thank you, Convener. I think this is a really important point. Emma's maintaining the fact that she believes that this can be dealt with through secondary legislation. We even had a discussion whether it should be affirmative or negative. But this gives tremendous powers away from, and Parliament is going to have to decide on this, whether Parliament wants to give away tremendous powers to ministers to authorise this, and we simply deal with it by secondary legislation. In previous legislation, and again I refer to the UEFA Act that we passed last year, members were not content with this and made it quite specific. The equivalent in this bill, which was enforcement officers or inspection officers, had to be appointed specifically and were qualified and had to have qualifications. What Emma has done with this drafting is say that, and we had a contribution there saying quite rightly that the inspecting of bodies can appoint in their own inspectors, and that's about money. Well, I'm afraid it's a lot more than about money. It's about fundamental principles of Scots law, and I think that's, we've really got to revisit this. That's all I would say to Emma.
Emma.
I am happy to take all of that on board and go back and look at it and have a discussion with the non-government team and look at the best way to take it forward. So if I do need to propose amendments for the face of the bill, I'm happy to do whatever is proportionate in order to make this successful. And to, I'm happy to work with Mike Rumbles to better understand this as far as what he is wanting me to change. So I'm happy to do that.
Mike, is that you concluded?
No, that's great. I thank Emma for that response. Very helpful.
Okay. Emma, just before we move on to the next question, can I just come in at this stage and say I also have huge concerns regarding this use of investigating bodies out with the police. And I share the comments that have been made by John Finney and also by Mike Rumbles. And as a member of this committee, I would appreciate the opportunity to work with you on this, but I'd also like to some confirmation at this stage from you that you are listening to the concerns that have been raised by quite a few members of the committee, and that in the importance of getting this bill through, that you might have to reconsider this section quite considerably.
Definitely happy to work with everybody and listen and go back to potentially rewording the primary, the bill. So happy to do that if because obviously it seems like everybody has concerns.
Okay. Mike, did you want to ask any questions on the use of warrants, or were you satisfied that you'd had sufficient answers on that?
I think I would just like to flag this up because I think this is the really important issue about search warrants. And if Emma can look at this again, the way the bill is framed is a departure from established the legal norm in Scots law. Obviously, normally you'd apply for a warrant, and it says, say this in section 4 that you've got there, you'd normally apply for a warrant to search for evidence, and that's quite normal. But then it says in section 4.2, this subsection is complied with if either admission to the premises has been refused or such a refusal may reasonably be expected. So really, what's the point of applying for a warrant in the first place? And what section 4 seems to give, it does, this is what worries me particularly, it seems to give a power of entry to search for evidence which no other bill or act of Parliament has done. It's quite a major step from where we are. And again, we had the same issue in the UEFA bill last year. And I was just wanted to focus that if you could look at this particular aspect as well as the one we've just been discussing.
Emma, I wondered if Charles, who'd said that he'd wanted to come in on the issue of warrants, wanted to answer that particular question. It appears he has some views on warrants. Charles, do you want to come in on that?
Yep. So it's not a comment about the policy at all. Again, that's not my role as the drafter. It's just to flag that the provision in question is basically a direct lift from the powers given to inspectors and constables under paragraph 4 of Schedule 1 to the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006. That is including the ability to enter non-domestic premises without a warrant in order to, in the 2006 Act, it was enter premises and search for, examine and seize any animal, including the carcass of an animal, equipment, document or other thing tending to provide evidence of the commission of or participation in a relevant offence. It's narrower in the bill because the things for which a warrant can be granted are identifying the dog, ascertaining the owner, examining, seizing and detaining the dog rather than documents and other things. Just as a drafting matter, that's where that drafting comes from. It comes from the 2006 Act.
Thank you, Charles. Stuart, you wanted to come in. So I'll bring Stuart in and then come back to you, Emma, if you want to add anything. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. Just to ask the member in charge whether she's aware that the Salmon Fisheries Act provide warrantless access to water bailiffs under circumstances a bit wider than she is proposing and rather similar to the ones that have just been described by Charles.
Emma.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I did see the earlier evidence session where Stuart Stevenson did mention the issue of water bailiffs. I guess I would just finally point out the 1953 legislation does allow for the police to obtain a warrant to enter and search premises if there are reasonable grounds for believing that a dog on the premises was involved in an offence. And again, this might relate back to 50% of livestock warren offences are by dogs that are unaccompanied or latchkey dogs. So the current 1953 legislation doesn't allow you to seize a dog if you've got a warrant. My understanding is that this was to enable a dog to be picked up or taken to a place of security or safety, and so that further to make sure that evidence could be gathered. And when we're talking about evidence, we're talking about wool in the teeth, in between the teeth of the dog, or blood, or so that we make sure that we can secure any evidence in order to help prosecute. But again, I am happy to go back and look at the language around this if that is needed in order to make it more clear and I guess appropriate as we move forward.
Okay, I think Emma, you've understood the concerns raised by the committee on this particular subject. So we're going to move on to the next questions. Mike, briefly, you want to come in, I believe, supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly to say that there is a difference, and I wanted Emma to appreciate this, that we understand this difference. There is a difference, as Charles was mentioning, between entering premises to seize evidence and entering premises to search for evidence, and that's a fundamental difference.
Emma, I'm sure you're nodding, so I think you've taken that on board. So I think I will stick to what I said, is that there are serious concerns raised by committee members here, and you've agreed to go back and look at it. So I may move on to the next questions, which are going to come from Christine Graham. Christine, don't look surprised.
Time
is up.
My normal expression. we're back to the gathering of evidence. We're into criminal prosecution. So the gathering of evidence has to be done properly to survive any prosecution. I'm looking at the question of consent to examining, let's say, in inverted commas, the offending dog. Who's going to give consent for that dog to be examined? Is it the police? If it's the owner standing there, the owner probably isn't there. And if there's no owner there, who will give consent? Because a dog is property in law, and you can't just go on a fishing expedition, which would be if you had nobody's consent to do it. You just examine the dog anyway. So that's the question. It's quite serious because that's the kind of thing in which a prosecution might fail.
Emma.
Thanks for that question. The police would direct any examination to be carried out. My understanding is that the current practice is that the police would take evidence based on witness statement or photographic evidence. That's primarily what happens right now. But if there was further evidence needing to be gathered, like wool from the dog's teeth, or in some cases I've heard about an emetic being given to a dog, that would all be done by the police as they currently do. So that wouldn't be stepping away from current process.
Can I ask, I noticed earlier you had discussions with the Crown Office, who at the end of the day would be carrying out the prosecutions. What was their view, or its view, of gathering evidence and the issue of consent here to getting the evidence?
I haven't spoken to the Crown Office directly. They've fed into the consultation and I've written to them further, so I'm waiting on a response from them. I'm aware that the Minister has met the Crown Office and I'm seeking a response to what the outcome of that was as well. So I will need to find out or chase up that response and feed that back to the committee.
So let's say that we overcome the issue of consent, which I don't think we actually have. A vet would have to do the examination of the animal, I'm presuming. So who's going to pay the vet to do this? And on top of that, I suspect that vets would have to have some kind of education or training into how to obtain this forensic evidence. They may already have it. So there's a couple of questions there. But one of them, I think, apart from the training, which I think we can overcome, who's paying for the vet's time?
Emma, Nick Hawthorne wants to come in. So I'm very happy to let you head off on this or bring him in now, whichever suits you.
I'm happy if you want to bring Nick in and I can then follow up with the notes that I have regarding vets. Okay, I'm happy for Nick to come in.
Nick, off you go.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it was just a quick point in direct response to Christine Graham's questions. The bill actually provides for the legal authority to have a dog examined rests with either with the police or with the inspector if an inspector had been appointed. So the police and the inspector have the legal authority to have a dog examined, and that's in section 4.2 of the bill, which inserts new section 2B. You can find that power.
Okay, so Emma, back to you. We find out who can instruct it, who's going to pay for it, I think is what Christine's asking.
In looking at scenarios, we've made the language in the bill that if a dog is taken to a vet, that isn't what actually happens, although it could theoretically happen. But if a vet is on site examining sheep, looking after sheep that have been attacked, then at that point, that is where the examination would take place. And the costs would currently be covered by an inspecting body, or as we move forward, it would be incurred by the Crown Office or the Scottish Government ultimately. So that's something that in exploring the discussions with the minister, that the payment would be determined if it's a direct payment by the government initially.
And Christine.
And do you have in mind, I know this is getting down to little details, but they're important. Do you have a fee structure in mind so that, you know, vets know where they are? They already have fees. You know, you take your cat, get something done, there's a fee structure, or is it based on time?
Thanks, Convener. In speaking to a local vet recently, he said that, you know, what he would normally do in the course of, if he was taking evidence for a livestock worrying case, it would be similar to what he would be doing for usual work anyway, like taking blood swabs, managing the response of an emetic with the dog. So there would be a fee structure. He would normally have it in place. I haven't actually looked at the real detail on that, but I would imagine that operating protocols or procedures could be established in order to make it a fair and reasonable structure. And that way, again, as a lot, the evidence that's normally gathered isn't the detail of forensic evidence, but this bill allows that in the case of particularly of latchkey dogs. So it's something that I could look at in more detail and get back to the committee about.
Just a last bit. I mean, Chris, we know that, I support your legislation. It doesn't sound like I do the way I'm questioning it, but I do support it. But the issue is the practical operation of the law. And the other thing that crossed my mind is, if you're in a very rural area and vets are very busy people, and there isn't a vet to hand, and you're going to have to perhaps have, you know, a vet examining, if nobody says, oh, yes, I admit it was my dog, then, you know, who's going to, you know, detain the dog, as it were? What's going to happen in those circumstances where a vet simply won't be around for hours, perhaps even a whole day?
Emma.
So local authorities have different ways of detaining dogs that are, unleashed dogs or dogs that are not accompanied. So depending on each local authority area, some have local authority run dog centres. SSPCA have their own as well. So a dog would be detained in a way if it was unaccompanied in the current way that stray dogs are. So that would be the process that I would envisage if that was required would happen. If a dog is accompanied, then I would imagine that they would go back to the place with their owner. But in order for, if it's an evidentiary issue, then it would need to be the vet either gathering evidence on site, or I've seen police, or I've heard the police take photographic evidence on site, and then dogs are able to be returned to their owner pending the investigation and the outcome of an investigation. So there are various models across Scotland as far as where dogs can be detained. Local police in Dumfries and Galloway, for instance, use a private-run canine rescue centre, but there are other methods or places where dogs can be held pending an investigation. And currently, the SSPCA use their own premises for seizure of puppies that are used for illegal puppy trafficking, puppy farming. So the SSPCA work with the police in that case in order to hold dogs pending investigation and outcome.
Thanks. I have no further questions on that unless somebody else wants to pick up on something.
Emma, just before we move on, perhaps you could clarify. What slightly concerns me is that an inspection is carried out of the dog by a vet, and the vet may be waiting months to get the money back from the for the costs of the inspection, either from the police or the courts. Do you think it's right that vets be asked to carry that charge when they're in a very probably difficult financial situation and making sure all vet bills are paid on time? And how are you going to make sure that happens, i.e. they get paid quickly?
It's a reasonable question to ask. I think that, again, the process of gathering forensic evidence hasn't been a relatively big issue up until now, but I would be concerned that courts would take an excessive amount of time in order to pay for a vet. So I would be happy to look at what kind of process could be developed where vets would be remunerated in a fast way. I would support that.
Thanks, Emma, for that. The next question comes from John Finney. Back to you, John.
Thank you, convener. Emma, of course, legislation should be the final step of dealing with something if other measures haven't been considered. Can I ask you, did you consider any other provisions that may deal with the prevention of incidents other than the deterrent effect of higher fines and greater powers of investigation, please?
Yep, we other issues that have come up during the whole process was education is one of the huge ones, and we looked at it, found it really difficult to figure out how to actually legislate to educate. I am aware already that education has existed. I know that Mike Flynn made a comment at the evidence session that basically said they've been educating for 30 years, but yet livestock worrying incidences are still increasing. And so the purpose of the bill will also raise awareness and show the severity of the offence. So in itself, we'll be able to provide education. I know that the Scottish Outdoor Access Code by Nature Scotland have got some great education modules and tools that they provide already. So rather than me put it in a bill, I would be keen for raising awareness to continue and using all these other tools that we have to support the updating, ultimately the updating of this 67-year-old legislation. The Outdoor Access Code have got great videos about how to train your dog to come back and train your dog to basically listen. And so I would support any opportunity to continue to use education as part of the raising awareness of the severity of this and then the bill as well.
Thank you for that, Emma. I mean, notwithstanding these excellent education, outdoor access videos and all the rest, as you say, it remains a problem. So is part of the plan to perhaps update some of that guidance to reflect, where this bill to be successful, to reflect higher penalties? Will what's already there be revisited? Would you encourage that?
I would encourage the higher penalties issue was something that was quite clearly sought after by the National Farmers Union and the Sheep Association as well, because of the issue of the severity and how it affects farmers both financially and emotionally. So I would be keen to make sure that there is a raising awareness of the penalties and the severity in this to obviously help make people aware of this issue as it's increased year on year for the last 10 years. So I would be happy to help support any way that we can raise awareness about the bill. One of the challenges was that the farmers' magazines, the farmers' newspapers are very happy to print issues around livestock worrying, but the non-farming printed media have not really been engaging at all. So that would be a way of educating the general public, the folk that are using the outdoors, and I would support any further raising awareness that way as well.
Well, I acknowledge your work in relation to puppy trading, illegal puppy trading as well. And of course, puppies are cuddly, whereas the remains of a savaged sheep, for instance, are not. But this is fundamentally an animal welfare issue. So it is to understand that you've fully explored options short of legislation.
Well, when we looked at the whole process going back, I mean, the fact that the legislation is 67 years old, and it's predominantly the primary legislation that's used for livestock worrying offences. And you're right, it's an animal welfare issue. I've heard of calves being chased till they died of exhaustion, for instance. So we explored, you know, initially it's about education and raising awareness, as well as in tandem updating a law that is back in 1953. And so farming practices have changed since then. And I wanted to reflect the modern farming practice and including, you know, the cost of sheep in relation to where they were in 1953 to where they are now. So in tandem, other things can be done, but the legislation, I feel, does need to be updated.
Okay, I would just conclude by a comment that old legislation isn't necessarily bad legislation, but of course it has to reflect current need. Thank you for that. Thank you, Convener.
John, were you going to ask about databases for dog controls? No, that's Oliver. I'm sorry. I was miscalling you, so I apologise. Oliver, I think you're up next.
I was going to ask about databases, but first, I just wanted to ask, in their submission, SLE proposed that there should be a legal obligation placed on any dog owner to report any incidents to the police and to assist with any investigations. Do you think that that would be a helpful thing to include within the bill?
We've thought about the issues of if I, as a dog owner whose dog attacked sheep, then it's if I was to report that to the police, then there might be self-incriminating issues, and then how do we follow that up? And there was a bunch of questions was raised about that, and we found that would be unworkable to put in the bill, because it would add more complexity to it. So I did not pursue to put this self-reporting into the bill.
Thanks, Emma. Oliver.
I'm going to move on to my next question, but I'd be grateful if there's any more information you could provide me with on that in terms of the kind of information you looked at to come to that conclusion. But I'd be happy to look at that sort of separately. And it was to ask really about the dog control notices database. Do you think it would be helpful to sort of include more information on dog control in the database? And if so, would this bill be the place to provide such information or provide for such information to be collected and stored? And do you think that there's more work we need to do on standardising the collection of data? We've heard from stakeholders that, you know, the collection of data on dogs and dangerous dogs is not always consistent you know, across the country.
I've found the information in my notes about the should owners have a legal duty to report suspected incidents. So I can take that information and send it back to you if that is helpful. And regarding databases, we did find that in this consultation process that data on livestock worrying incidents wasn't being collected in a same way across Scotland. So like the number of sheep attacked, whether a vet was involved, whether sheep had to be euthanized, what type of dog, how many dogs. So there was some issues in data gathering on the specific incidents. But during this process, when the Scottish Partnership Against Rural Crime launched their raising awareness of livestock worrying and other rural crime, I'm aware that the SPART are now collecting data that is more similar across the whole, I guess, across the whole patch. So that's encouraging. So there is a potential opportunity for further data. I know that the Minister's team are looking at that as far as their wider dogs and animal welfare legislation and dog control notices, for instance, and the gathering of other specific data. So rather than put it in this bill at the moment, I'm keen to see what the Minister's data process and management and future is. And that way, her bill or her future law will be able to have that data management issues within it.
Oliver.
I think I'm happy with that for now, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, Christine.
Yes, just an issue about this. Unfortunately, the database for dog control notices that's been discussed is being dealt with by the Justice Minister, and this legislation has been dealt with by the Minister on Animal Welfare. And I think just a comment to be made that to ask the member to ensure which minister is going to deal with the database system and everything else, because that crosses two portfolios, and I think that's causing an issue.
I think the member's nodding that she's noting that. I don't think she's going to work out who's going to do it or who's going to refuse to do it. Sorry, Emma.
Actually, the civil servant that was with the minister was actually working with the communities team, which is Ash Denham's team as well. So, yes, there's cross-portfolio issues, but my understanding is that the particular civil servant that's looking at data and additional data management is part of the justice portfolio.
Okay. Thank you, Emma. Richard Lyle, I think you've got some questions. Richard.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Again, Emma, can you let us know what conversations have you had with the Scottish Government regarding resourcing for additional investigation, including for the inspecting body that you were asked about earlier? Enforcement and prosecution that may come as a result of this bill. How would the inspecting body be resourced? Can you give us any information on that?
In my engagement with the ministers, my understanding would be that initially the resourcing for what was required in the bill would be covered by the Scottish Government. In the financial memorandum, the Scottish Government support the bill and agree to processes going forward. Again, if the ministers decided they wanted an inspecting body, that also would be financed through Scottish Government at the moment. So that is my understanding as in my conversations with the minister, that right now it would be Scottish Government that would be supporting any requirements to finance aspects of the bill.
That's fine. That's me, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Peter, I think you've got a question you want to ask. Peter.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, we have investigated, Christine Graham kindly investigated the costs of for the vets, who pays for the vets. But I just wonder, the vets have also said that they would need some, might need some additional training or additional resources in forensic procedures and evidence handling. And I just wonder, who's going to pay for that?
Emma.
Again, any necessary education for vets would be supported by the Scottish Government. The vet that I spoke to said that it's normal procedure for taking blood or swabs or other types of processes is something that a qualified vet is already competent to do. I would imagine that additional issues might be around labelling of samples and chain of custody and securing of evidence. So that would be developed through processes and procedures that then could be delivered either electronically, digitally, education modules that way, but the Scottish Government would work with stakeholders like the BVA to help deliver that education if there was much further education that was required.
Just another issue that we heard from the vets, that there's a potential serious conflict of interest here. If a vet's on site because he's there to treat the livestock, the sheep that have been injured, and at the same time the dog is presented to the vet and he's asked to investigate whether this is a dog that did the job, or did the worrying or not, There's a serious chance of a conflict of interest here, and the dog owner might say, well, the vet was obviously influenced because he's been paid by the farmer, he's on site and he's asked to be there by the farmer, so I don't accept that his evidence is clear and concise and fair. How are we going to address that? Because the likelihood is that if there is a vet on site, he'll likely end up examining the dog as well as treating the animals.
Emma.
Yep, Peter's absolutely right that the same vet would be dealing with the sheep first on site and then perhaps the same dog. The conversation I had with my own vet last week was that the vets are professionals, just like medical doctors and healthcare professionals, that they treat everything impartially, and that my understanding would be that I was assured that, like doctors, that any work that was carried out would be carried out impartially, just like if a dog had fought another dog. So I don't believe that the professionals would see this as a conflict of interest.
Thank you. Angus McDonald, I think, Angus, you've got some questions now.
Yep, thank you, convener. If I could stick with the issue of resources, I mean, awareness amongst the public is clearly extremely desirable, which you've already touched on, Emma. But can I ask, what conversations have you had with the Scottish Government regarding resourcing for preventing livestock worrying incidents? Have you had that discussion so far?
Discussions are ongoing, and I am keen to again analyse what particular financial implications there would be for the bill. Initially, the financial memorandum reported that we might see an uptake or an increase in reporting of incidents. So there would be an increase in costs initially, but ultimately, as the bill is used and people are more aware about it, then there would be a reduction in costs in order to deliver the outcomes that we're seeking in the bill. So in my work with the minister, I'm continuing to look at the financial aspects of the bill and basically take apart what would be ultimately the cost and who would bear the brunt of that cost. But ultimately, if the bill is to be successful, we should see the cost of cost to farmers, the cost to everybody reduce as we see the incidence of livestock worrying reduce.
But specifically with regard to prevention before the event, have you had discussions on that regard?
The prevention aspects are obviously really important, because I'd rather prevent the offences in the first place. So in the I guess the conversation with Scottish Government, we're looking at the Scottish Outdoor Access Code and working with the Outdoor Access Forum to look at how can we continue to raise awareness through education. My conversations with the SSPCA are that they are already going into schools and educating kids about responsible ownership. And part of responsible ownership is to make sure you, if you have a dog and you're around livestock, is don't go into the field in the first place. And so my conversations with the government will be focused around additional preventative measures. And I'd like to see a raise an awareness campaign or a public campaign to help support everybody out there to gain more information. We know that the NFUS and the Sheep Association and everybody already do education ahead of lambing season. So it might be that the government maybe needs to help support a more joined up stakeholder approach with a national public messaging campaign. And so I will have those conversations with the minister to see if that's possible.
Okay, that's good to hear. Can I also ask what conversations you've had with the Scottish Government about the time frame for the implementation of the bill? Does 6 months after royal assent, give sufficient time to appoint inspectors, for example?
6 months is the normal process or the normal time frame for enacting a bill after royal assent. And at that point, the government may not even have decided whether we want inspectors or not. So so the bill's introduction shouldn't be impeded by processes that the government might not choose to enact at the moment. So the 6 months is normal for any bill to take effect. I suppose if delays were required, it might be that we need to look at delaying that 6 month implementation for a further length of time if that was deemed necessary by the government. So I would seek to get further confirmation from the ministers if they thought 6 months needed to be extended.
Okay. That's good. Thank you.
Thanks, Angus. I think, Oliver, you had a follow-up on that you wanted to come in on. Oliver.
Yeah, it may be going back to Richard Lyle's question a little bit as well, but I just wondered, we'd heard in some of the evidence sessions, just, you know, and it's something I pick up on in my constituency work, but it's not a constituency question, convener, that the police sometimes, you know, are sort of seen to put a lot of resource into policing wildlife crime, but not, you know, not as quick to act on livestock worrying. And it's not just about sort of new resource with the bill, but are you hopeful there might be some reprioritisation of resource within Police Scotland to make sure that through the bill that livestock worrying is taken more seriously, and that the police resource that is in rural communities is being used to tackle issues that are of most importance to those communities?
Emma.
Yep. Originally, we had initial feedback from farmers as well that basically said that there's no point reporting an incident because the police don't really care. But in my work with Alan Drawn and John McKenzie, Alan's the Chief Inspector for Scottish Partnership Against Rural Crime, and our local guys, they are absolutely committed and they take this seriously. I think the work of Spark has been phenomenal. I've seen them at a lot of the events over the last year before COVID, at the cattle shows and agricultural shows, at the Royal Highland Show, as well as at Turf. And my understanding is that the police are taking this very seriously, livestock worrying as part of other rural crime work. So I do believe that as we move forward and the bill gains this more notoriety as it's being updated, that the farmers will have confidence that our police do take it seriously.
Oliver, are you happy with that?
I'm happy with that for now, Convener. Thank you.
OK, thank you. There's a question from John Finney as well. Back to you, John.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. Emma, as you know, I've previously declared I'm supportive of your proposal in broad terms. I'm therefore somewhat dismayed to see the number of exemptions that there are to this. Why would there be exemptions for work dogs, arguably dogs which you could argue are trained to a higher level? Why on earth would you have exemptions?
Emma. The exemptions are for working dogs that, like one example might be an assistance dog for somebody who has mental health issues. So if the dog did worry livestock in the course of its work, then that issue might need to convey exemptions in order to support equalities issues. So there's other issues that we looked at that would maybe, you know, the widening of dogs that are supportive dogs. So in the original 1953 legislation, it was dogs that were assisting people who were visually impaired. But now we've got dogs that are supporting in many other areas as well. so the exemption
Emma, sorry,
is...
Could I perhaps interrupt you there, and I perhaps should have made clear, I've personally no issue with assistance dogs, hearing dogs, and clearly not for those with visual impairment. I'm particularly thinking of gun dogs and foxhounds, presumably trained to a higher standard. So why would you exempt them? What happens if a farmer has his livestock worrying? Who determines, for instance, that they're performing a role? I mean, is definition of that? Is that not something best left to mitigation in a court rather than... It just sends to me a very, very weak message about the overall direction that you're outlining exemptions.
John, sorry to interrupt, but Nick Hawthorne would like to come in as well, Emma. So I don't know, I'll give you the option again. Would you like him to come in now, or would you like to answer the question first yourself?
Just quickly before Nick comes in, the hunting dogs are supposed to be used for flushing. So if a dog is now not acting in the purpose of what's intended as current flushing out a fox, for instance, then they're not in control anymore. But ultimately, I think the Crown Office would be the able, or the prosecutors will be able to determine that as a case by case basis. So I'm not suggesting that we exempt hunt dogs completely, but that would be something that would be taken on board in the act that of what actually happened in a particular incident. And I'm happy to have Nick expand on that.
Nick, briefly, if you would, please.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, and very briefly, because Emma's subsequently covered some of what I was going to say, but my general point was that this is not a new exemption in the basic sense. The exemptions are there in the 1953 Act, but the Bill's made, as say, some changes in terms of assistance of and to the extent that the dog is performing the role in question when talking about the gun dogs and the other things that John Finney was mentioned. But the broad policy here is untouched from the 1953 Act.
Back to you, John.
Of course, there's been representations from the UK Association of Animal Lawyers, who I would have thought Emma would be very keen to refer to about this. So is your view that the matter would be reported and then it would be a matter for, in the first instance, perhaps the Procurator Fiscal to determine whether this was something that should be prosecuted, or there is this mitigation that would be presented to the Sheriff? I'm unclear on this, because it seems to me that it creates an extremely unfortunate precedent, and I appreciate that this may well have been in the previous legislation, but this is being updated and it's an opportunity to right an inconsistency, I would say.
John, again, sorry, just to help Emma with this, Charles Livingston wants to come in. So I'm going to bring in Charles first and then come back to you, Emma, because Charles may be able to shed some light on it. Charles.
Yeah, it's just one technical point, which is that the exemption is only to subsection 2C, which is the offence of being at large in a field or enclosure in which there are sheep. So a police dog, a guide dog, a pack of hounds, if they were to attack or chase livestock, the offence would still be committed. The exemption is only to the offence of being at large. So I think as Nick said, this was in the 53 Act. I think the intention there will be that if in the course of a hunt, a pack of hounds crosses a field in which there are sheep, because that's where the hunt takes them, that is not an offence, because by definition, a pack of hounds is not going to be on a lead or under close control. So it is an exemption only to the being at large offence. And I think that will be what informed the original parliamentary intention.
Emma, I'll come to you. John, perhaps you could let me know whether you're happy with that answer.
I'm grateful for Mr. Livingston's clarification. I think it's important that there's absolute clarity about the range and scope of the legislation.
Thank you. Emma, I'm assuming, therefore, that is there anything you want to add to that?
No, I'm just to make sure that the explanatory notes and the guidance that support the bill would actually have very clear, defined information about how Charles has described the subsections perfectly. So that's something that I will take on board and maybe need to go back and look at those additional supporting documents.
Okay, thank you. John, on the basis you're happy, I've just got a very quick question before we move on to the last question, which is from the Deputy Convener. But just on assistance dogs, Emma, are you happy that the equalities groups regarding the exemptions of assistance dogs feel that their concerns have been answered?
In my engagement with the Outdoor Access Forum, we were able to receive, I guess, supportive wording that in the Outdoor Access Forum's engagement with equalities groups, that what I was proposing was appropriate and proportionate, and they were quite satisfied with how I was taking this bill forward.
Thank you very much, Emma. Now to the Deputy Convener, Maureen Mark. Maureen.
Thank you, Convener. Emma, when we heard the evidence from the Minister, I think we all got the impression that there were still a lot of areas of the bill where further discussions between yourself and the Minister were required. Have you had any meetings since we took evidence from the Minister with her or her officials to kind of tidy up some things? And I can already see, you know, quite a lot of amendments coming, perhaps from yourself, but also from the Minister. And also, we talked about the lack of police wands for reading chips, for example. Might be my mistake, but I haven't seen any financial resolution to this bill. So is there a cost to this bill, and roughly what is it?
Emma.
I am having ongoing conversations with the Minister. I had a brief catch-up session before the evidence session, but there have been issues raised, and because the government's research happened while my bill was being drafted, and then there's the overlapping work that the Minister is doing with other legislation, it means that there's issues that have now came up that obviously I do need to address, and I'm happy to go back and look at that and then respond to any issues. The issue of police wands was something that was interesting to me, because I would assume that the police would have microchip detection devices, some of which cost like less than 50 quid and some are about 190, depending on the type of wand. So that's something that needs to be looked at. It might be that we are able to help support identification of latchkey dogs very easily if the police were supported to have a wand in their vehicles, for instance. And the financial resolution, I would have to dig it out, but the financial resolution didn't propose to exceed any issue around members' bills that would require funding to go to the Scottish Parliament for approval, as in a financial resolution. But when the information was looked at, they basically said that there was not going to be a really extortionate level of requirement in order to finance the bill. But I can find that specific information and send it on if I need to.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think that almost brings us to the end. My one question just at the end is just about making people aware of this legislation when it comes in, because the importance will be making people aware. And what discussions have you had with the Minister about a publicity campaign so that no one's caught by surprise should your bill get through and all the processes it needs to, Emma?
As I said earlier, the Scottish Partnership Against Rural Crime did an extended campaign last year. So there's loads of stakeholders that are really interested in taking this forward. And so what my goal would be is to engage with the Minister to see if some government support could engage all the stakeholders to have one message so that we could have a national take the lead campaign type thing. So I would be happy to ask the minister if the government would support a public awareness campaign ahead of the go live date for the bill.
Thank you very much, Emma. And I think that brings us to the end of all our questions. So I'd like to thank Nick, Kenny and Charles for giving evidence. And to you, Emma, it must be odd for you sitting on the other side of the committee table being grilled rather than you doing the grilling. But thank you very much for the answers that you've given this morning. And we are now going to go into private session. Thank you.